My name is Eric Weidt, and I was the color grader on Mank. Mank is a movie about the writing of a movie, Citizen Kane, a very famous movie directed by Orson Welles. And so it's kind of meta that way. Fincher's vision for the movie is to set it back then in the early 40s and to have it look as if it were shot back then, basically.
Hello, everyone.
Make yourself to home, Mr. Mankiewicz, or shall I call you Herman?
Please, call me Mank.
The look of Mank was, there were certain elements right from the start that David was sure that he wanted, and these are elements that that refer to the look of films from the time, from the early 40s, also some film noir sort of references, but the things like blooming blacks, and which is basically the spreading out of the blacks in a kind of a blurry way, and then things like heavy grain at times, gate weave, and basically softening out the sides of the image to have softer, look like they were shot with it was shot with softer lenses. And the reason for that is because he obviously shot with a contemporary camera, which it was the red monochrome 8K, and with Leica Summilux lenses. And so that's obviously very sharp and pristine. And so the brief from the start was to artfully degrade the image in a way to look like it was a period that was shot in that period. There was other things like optical fades, optical dissolves, which have a very characteristic kind of like jump at the dissolve point, and kind of like the blacks in the gamma kind of going haywire, and the grain kind of exploding at that point. So these were all things that we needed to do throughout the movie. So right from the start, it was very creative and challenging and exciting to be giving such a strong look. You know, it's almost like one big visual effects piece at that point, but all done in DI, or a lot of it done in DI. My collaboration with David and Eric is first really just to find out what they want, you know, what they're looking for, which often is very, very technical, you know, referring to, you know, lenses or grains or optical processes that I first need to educate myself on, usually, and to just, you know, be able to make proposals based on these things. Like, you know, if David wants, you know, blurring of the sides of the screen, you know, I have to propose and make tasteful, sort of a tasteful set of like three options, you know, at least, and I have to anticipate what he wants on any given thing, and then also to kind of inject my own taste in what I intuit to be the right way as well. And so it's kind of like, a you want that, well, okay, here's a few things, and you know, I have my own sort of favorite in there, and we just, everything evolves from there. There's often many things to propose and to address. So it's kind of like my first goal is to please them, really, you know, and inject my aesthetic afterwards. What is next is things I've been working on already that will be coming out soon. David has an episode of Love, Death, and Robots season 3 that's a 20-minute piece that's all animation, and I'm grading that right now. I'm remastering Panic Room, which is an older movie from the early 2000s. I'm remastering that for high dynamic range. And there's The Killer, obviously, was the film he's shooting right now, which is based on a French comic, Le Tueur, by an artist named Mats, which is a feature film that's going to be, that is in color. They're shooting right now in various locations around the world. Actually, both of those two things, Love, Death, and Robots and The Killer, kind of gave me some insight into actually David's way of making movies a little bit, because they're from comics, basically. And I realized that he approaches filmmaking with the eye of a graphic artist. It can be seen in that way, in the sense that he basically shoots something which is, to him, is very rough. It's like a diamond in the raw, you know. And he absolutely loves the post-production, because that's where he's going to chisel away at this diamond and refine it and polish and all that, and make facets, you know what I mean? And this explains a lot, it might explain to some people that his real engagement with post and having the eye of the person actually drawing the cells in a comic. I think he sees that in his mind when he's conceptualizing a movie. So those are recent things I'm working on now that have actually, you know, given me a new angle on the director I'm working for. It's absolutely amazing to be part of it. I think the color grading it's evolved quite a bit, you know, and it's actually moved upstream into, you can really change the look, let's say, of a movie in profound ways. You don't always have to. You're not always asked to do so. But if a director or a DP really wants to impart something that can't be sort of captured in the camera, there's so much room for refining basically what was shot on set. And as such, I think that color grading has traditionally been a little bit in a kind of a dead zone in terms of recognition. You know, the color grader always knows, always feels like, yes, I'm bringing something to this, you know, when they have the time and they know that they've invested their passion for the image into what they're doing. And so I think it's a great thing, because it's something that the community of color graders is welcoming, I think. And I think it's probably an award that's going to just grow over the years. I'm really happy to see you guys start it.